So the two-dimensional example that we took in pretty much the last minute of the previous lecture was x plus 2y equal to 4 and 2x plus 3y equal to 7. Okay. And for this particular example, the matrix notation of this equation is going to be, I will put it in x1 and x2 just to make it more consistent with the notations we are going to use later. So the two variables are going to be x1 and x2 instead of x and y. Nothing really changes in this equation by changing the variables from x and y to x1 and x2, and I have changed from x and y to x1 and x2 so that extension to an n dimensional system becomes very clear when we actually do that extension. Okay. And then we have the right hand side. Right hand side is going to be 4 and 7, and the A matrix will be 1, 2 on the first row and 2, 3 on the second row. So we have 1, 2, 2, 3 on the second row, and in the matrix over here, the vector over here is 4, 7. Okay. So this is matrix A, this is X, this is B. And we will define a concatenated matrix A bar B as nothing but 1, 2, 4, 2, 3, 7. Okay. So these are our definitions for now. Okay. Now the question is, how do we go about solving it? And this is perhaps something that we have been trying solving from maybe the 7th or the 8th class. So this type of equation is not very difficult for us to really solve. What we will actually do is, we will first try to eliminate x1 or x2 from this equation. In this particular case, it's very clear that eliminating x1 is what we ought to be doing. So we will write this as equation 2 minus equation 1 multiplied by 2. Okay. So this is what we are going to do, but instead I will write it in this form, plus equation 2 multiplied by, sorry, plus equation 1 multiplied by minus 2. So 2x1 minus 2x1 will give us 0, 3x2 minus 4x2 will give us plus negative x2, and 7 minus 8, 2 into 4 is going to give us minus 1. Okay. And so this will be our new equation. So this was our equation 1, this was our equation 2, this we call as equation 3. Now using equation 3 and equation 1 together, we can then solve these equations in order to get the solution. So of course the one solution over here is x2 equal to 1, and then back substituting, in 1 Okay. So we put x2 equal to 1 over here, so x1 plus 2 equal to 4 and x1 equal to 2. Okay. And this is how, in a fairly straightforward manner, we have been solving these equations. Okay. So what we actually did was this. We had equation 1, which, let's again go back and think about it from a geometrical perspective. Equation 1 represented a line, so let me call that L1, which corresponds to x plus 2y equal to 4, and let's talk about the line L2, which corresponds to 2x plus 3y equal to 7. Okay. Now let us take a linear combination of the line L1 with line L2. Okay. And a linear combination basically means that we are going to take alpha L1 plus beta L2, where alpha and beta are two scalars. Okay. So let us look at the left hand side of this equation. It is going to be equal to alpha multiplied by x plus 2y, or rather I should use x1 and x2 rather than x plus 2 x and y. Plus beta multiplied by 2x1 plus 3x2. Okay. Now the solution of these two equations was the point 2 comma 1, right? So the solution was 2, okay. So let us substitute this particular value in this equation, we will get alpha multiplied by 2 plus 2, that is 4, plus beta multiplied by 4 plus 3, that is 7. Okay. So we have 4 alpha plus 7 beta, or alpha multiplied by 4 plus beta multiplied by 7, that is nothing but the RHS of alpha L1 plus beta L2. So the right hand side of alpha L1 plus beta L2 is going to be alpha times 4 plus beta times 7, which is the same as LHS. So what does it mean? What it means is that the point 2 comma 1, it satisfies the equation L1 and it satisfies the equation L2. That means this particular point lies on the line L1 as well as it lies on the line L2. But it also satisfies the equation alpha L1 plus beta L2, which means that for any scalar values alpha and beta, including alpha equal to 0 or beta equal to 0, the point 2, 1 is going to lie on that particular line. So okay. So we are interested in finding out this point, what this point actually is, and since this point also lies on a linear combination of these two line segments, as a result of this we can actually do any type of manipulations of this sort. That means equation 2 plus minus 2 multiplied by equation 1, and the result that we get is still going to pass through the solution of those two lines. And this is not just true for a two-dimensional system, this will be true for any n-dimensional system. If we have n equations in n unknowns, that is going to represent basically it is going to represent n hypersurfaces, and if we take linear combination of any hypersurfaces amongst those n hypersurfaces, the point of intersection of those hypersurfaces is also going to lie on the linear combination of those hypersurfaces. This linear combination and this property of the vector spaces is really the reason why this idea works of taking equation 2 and subtracting 2 times equation 1 from this equation. Okay. So this is how we did when we tried to solve this set of equations using the methods that we were familiar with. Now let us look at what we actually did so that we can learn some lessons from it and go ahead and try to implement that in the Gauss elimination process. The first part what we really did is something that we will try to relate to Gauss elimination. The second part that we did is something that we will relate to what is known as back substitution. Okay. So what we did in Gauss elimination is we took the matrix we took the matrix AB over here, okay, and then we subtracted from the second equation 2 times the first equation. So from this particular guy we subtracted 2 multiplied by this guy. Okay. So the AB matrix we had was 1, 2, 4, and 2, 3, 7. Okay. From this, the two equations that we were left with were these. Okay. So first we had equation 1 and 2. Okay. We did equation 2 plus minus 2 multiplied by equation 1, and we ended up with this equation. If this equation we have to write it, write this in basically a vectorial notation, in a matrix notation, it is going to be 0 multiplied by x1 plus minus 1 multiplied by x2 equal to minus 1. So I will erase this equation and write it in a different way. It is 0 multiplied by x1 plus minus 1 multiplied by x2. So now what we are left with is, we are left with equation number 1 and equation number 3, and we will try to solve equation 1 and 3 together. That is exactly what we did in the back substitution step. Okay. So equation 1 is 1, 2, 4 in the matrix A, B, and equation 2, if we again go back to this, equation number 3 is 0, minus 1, minus 1. Our matrix A is going to consist of 1, 2, 0, minus 1. Our matrix B will consist of 4, minus 1. And when we put those two matrices together, the first row will contain 1, 2, 4. The second row will contain 0, minus 1, minus 1. Okay. So what happened is, we went from this matrix AB to this new matrix AB. And how did we go ahead and get this particular matrix? This particular matrix we got by taking row 2 and adding minus 2 multiplied by row 1 as row operation. Okay. So what we are going to do in Gauss elimination is to do the following. Okay. In general, what we are going to do is, we will take the jth row, in this particular case the second row, and add to it some coefficient alpha multiplied by the ith row. Ith row in this particular case was first row. So specifically, what we did over here is, we did R2, where the j is equal to 2 plus minus 2 multiplied by R1, where I equal to 1. So this is what we will do as a row operation in Gauss elimination step. So what row operation does, it replaces one of those equations from n equations with a linear combination. For example, in the problem that we just solved, what we did was, we replaced L2, the line L2, with the line L2 minus 2 times L1. So we replace the one of the lines with a linear combination of the two lines that we had in the previous equation. So this is one type of row operation. The second type of row operation is, we know that it does not matter whether we call one particular line L1 and L2. Instead of calling this line as L1 and this line as L2, we could have very well called this line as L2 and this line as L1, and it would not have made any difference. That means that by exchanging the two rows, the solution of the overall linear equations also remains the same. So the other type of row operation possible is exchange of rows. Okay. So these are the two row operations that we will use, such that we get an upper triangular matrix for the matrix A. So what do we mean by upper triangular matrix for matrix A is that all the values on the diagonal and above diagonal may or may not be zeros, but all the values below the diagonal have to be 0. Okay. So, we will try to get zeros in all the equations below equation number 1, we will get zeros for the variable x 1, below equation number 2 for all equations we will try to get 0 for the variable x 2, so on and so forth. And when we go back and check what we have over here, this is the A part of our matrix and this is the new B part. So, what we have done over here is A itself, we have got this as an upper triangular matrix. All the values below the diagonal are 0 in this particular case, and this is our new vector B. Okay. So, that is our Gauss elimination step using row operations. Convert matrix A into a lower triangular matrix. And the same row operations have to be implemented on the vector B as well. Okay. So, this is what we will do for doing the Gauss elimination. Okay. Let us look at another example, a 3-dimensional example, and then we will extend it to an n-dimensional system. I am taking the 3-dimensional example and I will use it to explain both Gauss elimination as well as another method called the LU decomposition method.